Mason was out of here. But thank you for that introduction, and thank you for allowing me to come and to talk with you and to tell you a little bit about who I am and what I have experienced. And what I'd like for you to do as I speak is really two things. I'd like for you to think about your own work and think about how your work intersects with mine. And then secondly, I'd like for you to think about your own leadership journey and where that's going and how your journey intersects with my journey. So I'm the Reverend Jeffrey Brown, and I pastored, as you heard, a church in the Boston area. Live in Dorchester, which is another section of Boston. And if you would have told me at the very beginning of my experiences that I was going to be a part of a public safety crime reduction strategy that would bring together unlikely partners like church pastors and police officers and social workers and government employees around a significant violence reduction strategy of 79%. I would have looked into your cup to see what you were actually drinking. And when I first started, I wasn't trying to be a part of anybody's crime reduction strategy. I had come to the Boston area to go to school, went to seminary, graduated, started going to get my doctorate in Cambridge while I was pastoring a church. And if you would have said to me, what is your ambition? I would have told you I wanted to be a mega church pastor. You ever heard that phrase? I wanted a 15, 20,000 member church. You know, I wanted my own television ministry. I wanted my own clothing line. I wanted to be a long distance carrier. You know, the whole nine yards, like these preachers. But after about a year of pastoring, my membership went up about 20 members. So, you know, mega church that was way down the road. But seriously, if you would have said, what is your ambition? I would have said to you, I just want to be a good pastor. I want to be with people through all of the passages of life, birth of children as they grow and go to school, to be there to celebrate with the family, to be with families through all of the crises of life, you know, when someone gets sick and you go and visit them in the hospital and have prayer. And then to be with families through all of those final passages when the matriarchs and the patriarchs, when they pass on, and you're there to gather the family together to live a life that was well lived. To be a good pastor to me was to be able to stand in front of a group of community members and to preach messages that would impact their lives. And in the African-American tradition, to be a good pastor also meant to be a good community leader. So I wanted to represent my community well in the work that we were doing there. And, you know, I guess I wanted to play the role too. So I wanted to wear a nice suit and have a brim hat and have a black car and roll the window down and wave when someone said, there goes the Reverend Doctor, you know. Wear plaid pants on the weekend. That's just to see if you were listening. Were you listening? But and that's what I was doing. I was pastoring. I was working. I was building programs in my church, trying to figure out how to increase the membership. And then there was something happening in the community that was getting my attention, and it got the attention of many of my colleagues around the area. And that was the homicide rate started to rise precipitously. And it was young people who were shooting and killing themselves and each other for reasons that I thought were very trivial reasons. You know, someone stepping on someone's sneaker at a high school hallway, and right after school, instead of going to fisticuffs, somebody would get shot. Or someone who would get shot because they were standing at the wrong corner with the wrong color shirt on at the wrong time, and because of that, they would get shot. Or you had two young men vying for the attention of a young woman, and she chooses one, and then the one that she does not choose decides to shoot the one that she does choose. For these reasons, these homicides were happening, and I realized that something needed to be done about it. So I looked at who I was and the resources that I had. I had this church and this congregation of people that I spoke to on a weekly basis. I had this nonprofit, 501c3, in which I could build programs. And so I started to preach, to crime the violence in the community. And I started to build programs for at-risk youth, trying to get them from going over the other side of the fence, if you will. And I would go to my ministerial meetings, and I was urging my colleagues to do the same thing. And I thought if we all got together, if we all collectively preached, decrying the violence in the community, and if we all started to build programs within our church to try to find ways to bring young people out of the streets and into the fold of the church, then perhaps we can make a difference with this violence. And they all started doing the same thing. So I was pretty satisfied with the fact that the faith community has made their contribution to the violence, and perhaps we could stem its tide. The problem was the tide of violence was not stemmed. It started to spiral out of control. One year in the city of Boston, we had, which is a city of about 650,000-700,000 residents, we had 152 homicides, 1,100 gun shootings. There were people who were getting shot who had absolutely nothing to do with the violence that was happening in the streets. People were getting shot going to get a pack of cigarettes at a convenience store or just sitting at a bus stop just waiting for a bus. Or they were in a park and they would get shot because there was a commotion that was happening on the other side of the park. And as we know, bullets don't have names on them. And so all of this was happening, and it started to change the character of the city. You could go to any housing project like the one that was down the street from my church, and you'd walk in there and you would see that it was like a ghost town because the parents would not allow their kids to come out and play, even in the summertime. You could listen in the neighborhoods on any given night, spring, summer, fall, winter, and to the untrained ear, it sounded like fireworks, but it was gunfire. You would hear it almost every single night in the communities. And you could go to any emergency room at any hospital on any given night, and you would see on gurneys, shot, dying, young, black, and Latino men generally. And I was doing funerals, but not of the venerated matriarchs and patriarchs, you know, who have lived a long life and you have a lot to say. But I was doing funerals of 18-year-olds and 17-year-olds and 16-year-olds and a 14-year-old. And I was standing in front of their family and friends at the church or at a funeral home, struggling to say something that would make some difference. It was very difficult, and I realized that what I was doing was not working, and so I looked again at what I was doing and started to preach harder, decrying the violence in the community, and started to look at the programming that I had in the church, trying to tweak the programming, looking at best practices if I could find them, and maybe I can incorporate them into my church. I even tried to be innovative in my preaching before. You all heard of rap music, right? I even tried a rap sermon one time. It didn't work, but at least I tried, right? I'll never forget the day I did that. I remember I was in the back, and you know, I usually greet the membership as they leave at the end of the service. And this young man waited until everybody was gone. And he walks up to me and he says, "Rap sermon, huh, Reverend?" I was like, yeah, what you think about that, man? He said, "Don't do that again." So I was preaching, I was looking at the programming, and I suddenly realized that what I was doing wasn't quite working. And so I started to look for answers. And there was a woman who was going around the communities at that time, and she was going to the housing projects, and she was touting a solution to the violence. And she was coming to the housing project that was right down the street from my church. And since I was a community leader, I decided to go and hear what she had to say. And to this day, I have never forgotten her words. She stood in front of those residents and myself, and she said the following. She said, "This scourge of violence that we're experiencing in our community, it's being done by a lost generation." You might have heard that phrase before, lost generation. Her solution was this: we need to take our time, our talent, and our resources, and we need to concentrate them on the generation that's coming up, because the generation that's experiencing this violence, they're a lost generation. When I walked out of there, two questions burned inside of me. The first question was, how can a community survive minus an entire generation? And then the second question was, if we decide to take our time, our talent, and our resources and concentrate them on the generation coming up, very likely they are the children of the generation that we've just thrown out. So I realized that wasn't the answer. But the question for me was, what is the answer? And then something happened to me that changed everything. It was a kid by the name of Jesse McKee. And he was walking home to the housing project down the street from my church. He was walking with his friend Rigoberto Carrion. And they met up with a group of youth that we later identified as members of the Vanpil Kings. Vanpil was a Dorchester-based group. Dorchester's a section of Boston. And they were there at the housing project because they had friends there. And they knew Jesse. Jesse had an after-school job at a radio station, so it made him a pretty popular kid. The day before, Jesse had bought a brand new leather jacket. And as they were talking with him, the conversation fell on the jacket. They started asking him questions like, where did you buy it? What kind of leather? How much was it? And then they tried to take the jacket from him. He refused to give it to them, and so they killed him. And they killed his friend simply because he was a witness to the whole thing. They tell me that as Jesse was running away from the scene, mortally wounded, he was running in the direction of my church. He died some 100, maybe 150 yards away from the church. If he would have gotten to the church, it wouldn't have made any difference because the lights were out. Nobody was home. When I got to the scene later on and they told me what happened, it was an image that I could not get out of my mind for days and weeks. Image of a young man in desperate need of help. If he would have ran to the church, church wouldn't have been there to help him because the lights were out and nobody was home. A few days later, they caught some of these youth who had done this dastardly deed. And to my shock and surprise, they were only a few years younger than myself at the time. But the gulf that was between us was vast. It was like we were in two completely different worlds. And I wrestled with these two images of a young man in need of help, but the church would have been there to help him, and these other young men who had done this deed, who were part of my own generation, but I knew nothing about their lives or the world that they lived in. And I wrestled with that, and as I did so, a funny kind of paradox started to emerge. I started thinking of all of the sermons that I preached, you know, including that rap sermon, by the way. I was preaching the crying of violence, but I was also preaching about building community. And I suddenly realized that there was a certain segment of my population that I did not include in my definition of community. And so the paradox was this: if I really wanted the community that I was preaching about, I needed to redefine my sense of community and reach out and embrace these youth that I had cut out of my definition, which meant not going after the youth who were at risk of violence, you know, those who were on the fence who could go either way, but I needed to go and connect with those who were involved in the violence, you know, the gang members, the drug dealers. As soon as I came up to that realization, a quick question popped in my head, which was, why me? I mean, isn't this a law enforcement issue? Why we got police, right? Why me? But as soon as why me came up, the answer came just as quickly. Why me? Because I'm the one who can't sleep at night thinking about all of this. Because I'm the one looking around saying, somebody needs to do something about this. And I'm starting to realize that someone was me. And isn't that how movements start anyway? They don't start with, you know, a grand convention, you know, excuse me, leaders, but I mean, you know, a grand convention coming together and you have an agreement and you all sort of walk out in lockstep. It usually starts with just a few or just one. Well, it started with me that way. I said, all right, if I'm going to involve myself in this way, and engage in this way, I need to understand the culture by which this violence is coming out. So I started to volunteer at the high school. After about 2 weeks of volunteering at the high school, I realized that the youth that I really needed to reach, they weren't going to high school. So I started to walk in the streets, and it didn't take a rocket scientist to realize that they weren't out during the day, but they were out at night, late at night. And so I started to walk the streets at night and started to go into the basketball courts where they were hanging out and making connections. And there were other clergy who had the same epiphany as I did. You know, they realized that it did no good to try to bring youth into the four walls of the sanctuary. They weren't coming. We needed to come out of the four walls of our sanctuaries and meet the youth where they were. But we didn't know each other. We were in our own communities, struggling with our own questions and issues. And then a crisis occurred that brought us all together. And we call that the Morning Star incident. It happened at the Morning Star Baptist Church in the Mattapan section of Boston. It's a funeral of a young man by the name of Robert Odom. He had been killed in a house party. It was very tragic. It was actually his birthday. And in Boston, they have these triple deckers, and his family lived on the top floor. And there was a group of youth who tried to come in, and they refused to let him in, so they decided to do a drive-by. You might remember that phrase, where they would just sort of go down the street and spray the street full of bullets. They concentrated their bullets into this place. Several people were shot and killed, and Robert was one of them. During the wake of his funeral, a young man comes in off the street. And what the family knew about this young man was that he and Robert were in the same music class together, and they were friends. And so they thought he was coming in to pay his respects and see his friend one last time. What the gang across the street from the church knew about this kid was that he was a member of a rival gang. And they thought he was going in to disrespect the family, maybe desecrate the body. So they ran in after him. He saw them, they started running. They pulled out their guns and their weapons, they started shooting in the middle of this wake. When the pastor came out to see what the commotion was, to his horror, they were stabbing him some 20 times in front of the altar. And they called that the Morning Star incident. That night, the pastor got on the airwaves and said, a line has been crossed in the community. And it is time for the community of faith to come together and to talk about how we're going to deal with the violence in our community. I'm looking for every available clergy in the Boston area to meet me at my church this coming Tuesday at 7 p.m. And we will talk about how the faith community will respond to the violence. And that following Tuesday, over 300 clergy from across the Boston area came together to talk about how the faith community was going to respond to the violence. And when I say everybody was there, I mean everybody was there. The Catholic cardinal and his entourage was there. The Greek Orthodox bishop and his entourage was there. The chair of the rabbinical council and the rabbis were there. The imams from the various mosques, they were there. All the Protestant heads of churches were there. You know, anybody who swung incense or wore a big ring or had a big medallion, they were all there. And for about 2 hours, eloquent speeches were given. And after about 2 hours of speaking, they decided to take action. First of all, to call a press conference, say that the faith community was united in talking about how to respond to the violence. And then the next action was to meet again the following Tuesday to talk about how the faith community was going to respond to the violence. And that following Tuesday, about 300 clergy came together again. And for about 2 hours, eloquent speeches were given. And then after about 2 hours of speaking, they decided to take action, to meet again the following Tuesday to talk about how the faith community was going to respond to the violence. And that following Tuesday, about 200 clergy came together again, and for about 2 hours, eloquent speeches were given. And after about 2 hours of speaking, they decided to take action, to meet again the following Tuesday and talk about it. Have you ever been in a process like that before? Let the church say amen. After about 9 weeks of this, and the numbers dwindling down to less than 70, the death knell was sounded to the process. Somebody stood up and said, you know, we should break off into committees. But during that period of time, I met Ray Hammond and Eugene Rivers and Sam Wood and Hesse Harris and Nellie Yarborough and Susie Thomas and Bob Fisher and Roland Robinson and Victor Curry. And we all started sitting together because we all had the same experience of realizing that we weren't going to get the youth to come into the four walls of our sanctuary, that we needed to come out of the four walls and meet the youth where they were. We were doing that in our own communities. And we started sitting together because our experiences were, shall we say, unique to most of the clergy that were assembled. And so we were sitting, talking, and reflecting upon what we were experiencing in our work. And at that last meeting, and it was the last meeting when they decided to have committees, one of us stood up and said, you know, we've been meeting here for over 2 months, and we have not asked one young person who's been out on the street to come into our meeting and to tell us what it's like to be out there on the street. And we ourselves have not collectively gone out there to find out what it's like to be there. And so as a joke, those who were running the meeting said, well, we'll nominate you as chair of the street committee, and everybody laughed. But it was like the zeitgeist moment. He said, all right, I'd like for everyone to meet me at my church, my house, 49 Harvard Street in Dorchester, this coming Friday at 10 p.m., and we will start the street committee. And that Friday, 10 p.m., about 13 of us, out of over 300, was at the house of Reverend Eugene Rivers. Now, Reverend Rivers lived in the Four Corner section of Dorchester. At that time, it was the most dangerous neighborhood in the city. Dealing with police community relationships as being these honest brokers, creating language, common language between police and clergy coming into our courts. Now, what's going on here? And we said, look, we've got this program we're trying to work, we're working directly with these youth. And they said, well, can we get in on that? We said, sure. And then probation officers started coming to these meetings. And then an amazing thing happened. Probation officers started to talk to police officers. Now, I thought that probation officers and police officers talked all the time. But I found out they didn't. Even though they were dealing with the same youth, they were operating in their own silos. And then we started to acquire people who ran community agencies and city agencies because they were getting money for high-risk youth, but a lot of those youth weren't getting to the programs that they were putting together. So we would approach them and we'd say, look, if you're looking for some high-risk youth, we got some high-risk youth for you. And we started to move some of them into the programs. And then the private sector got involved because as the violence went down, the business climate started to improve. Made for a great case to support what we were doing. And then lastly, and I don't know why lastly, city government got into it and started working with us. And so it's true, in Boston we had this reduction of violent crime over an 8-year period that was 79%. The national average at that time was 35%. And you could look at all of the numbers as to why that occurred, the decline of crack as a drug of choice was happening in the 90s, the rise of community policing in major cities was also happening. The economy was also robust in the 90s, if you remember. Those were all factors. But we had a 79% reduction. And there's a more remarkable number that I wanted to share with you.
And that is, in that period of time, when we had that high of 152 homicides, most of those were juvenile related. It was either juveniles who were shooting or juveniles who were being shot and killed. We went from that high to a 29-month period in which we had zero juvenile homicides. And that's why they call it the Boston Miracle. When they ask me, why was it so miraculous, I would always respond by saying, it had less to do about the youth deciding not to shoot each other, but it had a lot to do with adults being able to come together and check their egos at the door and to be able to see something as greater than the sum of their parts. I've got one story to tell you, and then I'll be through. I remember receiving a phone call from the police commissioner. He calls me and he says, what have you done to my men? I'm like, okay, you need to unpack that for me, commissioner. And so he starts talking about a meeting that he had with his captains. And it was some kind of equipment meeting, and I guess he thought they were gonna talk about getting more guns and bigger guns. I mean, I don't know what they do at equipment meetings. And one captain says, I understand that there's some Justice Department money available. I'd like to get some for the youth program that I'm running in my district. And then the other captain said, well, if you're gonna do that for him, I'd like to have some release time for my officers because I do a fundraiser running up the John Hancock Tower downtown Boston, raising money for the youth program that I'm running in my district. Another captain says, well, if you're gonna do that for them, I also have a youth program that I run in my district, and I would love to get the money for that. And the commissioner knew that those programs were related to 10 Point, the churches in the 10 Point College. So he calls me up and he was like, you're turning my police officers into social workers. I know I get a clap on that one. And I said, you think that's bad? If there are clergy walking around here like they're police officers. It was a time in which we were able to do business differently. And it had largely to do with listening and not preaching. And being able to suspend judgment while we listen. And to be able to embrace each other for who they are. It's kind of interesting to say that, one of my good, good friends is a gang member or a former drug dealer. So interesting for him to say, the Reverend is my boy. But that's what happens when you have the courage to listen. Thank you for listening. I really appreciate it.
South side of Chicago.
Yes.
Replication of some model like this, what can be done, what's being done?
Yeah. So in the South side, there are two clergy that I've had relationship with in the South side and in the West side of Chicago. Michael Flager is a longtime colleague of mine, and he's working with two clergy groups right now. And a lot of the work that he does is really a replication of the work that I've done in Boston. It's always a matter of scale in Chicago. And another thing about what works is that Boston's policing is really on the solid progressive side. And in Chicago, they've had challenges around that. And so it really is about trying to secure and to strengthen those stakeholders so that an effort like this can happen and be possible. But in the meantime, we've got Flager in the South Side. There's a group that's working with Marshall Hatch out there in the West Side. We're delivering lots of prayers as that goes on.
Employment programs, recreation programs, family strengthening, probably less common. Do you have a sense from your watching youth programs grow in Boston, what advice would you give others who are working on developing youth programs?
Yeah, there are a number of innovative programs that are happening in the city of Boston. The ones that I really like, from the youth employment to the teen empowerment, which is another program, the Louis D. Brown Peace Institute, which is in the city, are those programs that really value the wisdom and knowledge and the understanding and the intellect of the youth themselves, or those who are involved. You know, when you have a program that doesn't look at youth as the problem to be solved and start looking at them as who they are, which are assets, which are people, which are partners, you know, in this whole thing, then those are the kinds of programs that have an edge. You know, one of the problems of those programs is really how do you manage the time-consuming, labor-intensive nature of that we're particularly when you're dealing with high-risk youth and families. And, you know, I've seen some programs with some pretty decent strategies, you know, around that. The Peace Institute being one of them. So it's those kinds of programs that really sort of make the day, I would say. Yes, ma'am.
Good evening, Ashley Stewart from Ohio State University. Thank you so much for coming and sharing with us. I was just wondering, what was your perspective, or what was some of the ways that you all were able to cope with the community, particularly around potential traumatic stress or the trauma that was experienced related to the violence?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. It's always a difficulty because, you know, it took us a while to get the city to understand that, you know, trauma is a community-wide issue. When I was running 10 Point, we were talking to youth and we were like, you know, we were doing a lot of memorial services. So they would have street memorials around the person who had been killed. And the youth had asked us, could you come and say prayers around that? So we were doing lots of those. And, you know, what I would tell to the pastors, particularly those who weren't interested in the work, is that if you really want to see the impact of spirituality, not church or religion, but spirituality, you should go to one of these, because hundreds of youth show up. And so they asked us to put together a trauma conference in which we talk about community-wide trauma. And this was in the middle of August, you know, sweltering heat in a middle school that didn't have any air conditioning. And so I didn't think a whole lot of people would show up. And it was almost a fire hazard. We had so many people in there. And it wasn't just youth, but it was, you know, the grandmothers, the grandfathers, everybody was there. And so our public health department, you know, is now in tune and trying to develop programs around community-wide trauma and how to, you know, get workers into the community and into the churches to, you know, to be helpful, you know, around that. So we're just at the beginning stages of that, but, you know, there's some encouraging signs. You're welcome.
Hi, I'm Ruth Chambers from California State University, Long Beach, and first of all, thank you so much. Thank you, and I wanted to ask you, what are your thoughts or advice in terms of getting professionals together to be able to work to reduce the silos? I appreciate your thoughts about the youth and listening to them. So then as social workers and law enforcement and the faith community, how can we work together to be able to do that?
You know, what's interesting is that when we first started doing this work, and we first started bringing together the cops and probation officers, for example, you know, we just thought that it happened all the time. And when we found out that it wasn't, you know, it sort of shocked us. I remember bringing together social workers, public health officials, police, probation officers, educators, you know, on a project. And, you know, and I wanted to talk about the project, but they immediately started talking about developing an MOU, you know, that would, you know, sort of define the working relationship. I said, can we not do that immediately? You know, can we begin to talk first, and, you know, and then, you know, after that, let's see what we can do, you know? So, I mean, so part of what happened, at least with us, is that having, you know, some folks in there who may not be married to, you know, the MOU strategy, to say, look, you know, let's try and do it a little differently, and then see if something emerges from that. And if you want to write it down, you know, we can write it down. I can't say that it was, you know, easy. You know, a lot of those conversations were difficult, you know, at times, but we were able to come to some kind of common understanding, you know. And I understand, you know, the legal, you know, ramifications of you know, some of the relationships that we were talking about. All I was saying to them is that, you know, as we, you know, fuss about MOUs, you know, we're visiting these homicide scenes, you know, on a nightly basis. We've got to figure this out somehow. So it was the urgency of that, I think, that, and maybe having someone like me sort of keep that urgency forward is what's helpful. So I hope that helps us.
Oh, one last question, Will Ron.
Ron Astor from the University of Southern California. And first, I want to thank you for the fantastic work that you did. It's a role model and inspiring. My question has to do with schools. And the data that we have is from California. So in California, about 78% of all the kids identify as gang members in public schools. We also have about 300,000 of weapons each year reported by kids on school grounds. That's guns, knives. The way schools have been dealing with it is expulsion, suspension, which leads to the school-to-prison pipeline. And I'm wondering, in this whole strategy, or ideas or lessons that you might have for educators, so that we, our only strategy is not to expel or to suspend, but also to keep those schools safe, because about 175,000 kids in California a year say that they've been threatened by guns and weapons and other gang members too, so we have the two sides of the coin. Any thoughts or suggestions you might have for, let's say, the state of California, given your lessons?
I would say that when we work with the schools, and we've done work with schools, and we've had our clergy working, you know, in both middle schools and high schools, as we've done the work, it's really been important for the principals to see the value of having, you know, community leaders who really care about the violence, you know, come in and talk with youth about creating, you know, perhaps some diversion programs, you know, for the youth, some kind of in-house, in-school, you know, would probably amount to like in-house, in-school suspension, but some kind of program by which we could sort of bring the kids and sort of bring them back to the brink, from the brink. You know, we've done a lot of work with young girls. I mean, as you know, young women are as involved with the violence as the young men. They aren't always the shooters, but they're, you know, they're all intertwined. And what we found is that by working, and they also tend to stay in school longer than the boys. And so working with high school girls and, you know, really does a lot to impact that culture of violence that happens out on the street. You know, it's kind of tough, you know, in terms of education and bringing them back into school. You know, we tended to create GED programs and have them run in the projects where they live so they can feel safe while they're learning. And that's always been an alternative, but it's a tough one to crack. So, yeah.
Thank you all.
So, Reverend Brown, thank you very, very much.